name of Jesus Christ, Lord God, for having the blessed woman of God to come before us today. We thank you, Father God, for Minister Roxanne French, Heavenly Father, from Trinity United Methodist Church. We thank you, O Lord God, that she is a blessed woman of God, and we ask you, Father God, this day, that she come forth in your power, in your might, and deliver the word that you have spoken into her heart, and no weapon formed against it shall prosper. And we thank you, Lord God, for your blessings upon her. Lord, have your way this day, and may every seed, Father God, that is sent, multiply into the hearts of fertile souls in Jesus Christ's name. Our minister, Roxanne French, thank you. Okay, Heavenly Father, we thank you this day, O Lord our God, for Minister Roxanne French as she brings forth your word, Father. May you be glorified and magnified. We thank you for this anointed woman of God that is bringing us your word today. May it fall on fertile ground and bring forth much fruit for the kingdom of heaven. In Jesus Christ's name, Lord, we thank you for Minister Roxanne French.
Amen, and thank you. Thank you, God, and Pastors Allen and Benjamina Jenkins, for allowing me to preach from the Fresh Manna Ministries platform this morning. I also would like to thank my church family, my friends, my coworkers, everyone that called in to support me to hear a word from the Lord today, and also the Fresh Manna Ministries. Everyone from Fresh Manna Ministries as well. I will open with prayer. Lord, you are awesome in every way and the source of every good thing that I have. The life that I am building is a temple that belongs to you and only you. I am asking for you to strengthen my spirit this morning so I will be bold when speaking of your greatness. Guide my heart to speak truth at all times, and empty this vessel of self and fill me with your word, your love, and your Holy Spirit. I believe you, and I believe in you. And in Jesus' name, I pray this morning, amen, amen, and amen. This morning, if I had to give a title to the word that I'm going to speak today, it would be the second part to Hannah. The first part is already out there. The audio file is on the Fresh Manna Ministry website. And now this is Hannah part two, and the title is The Power of Prayer. The Power of Prayer. Praying to God consistently deepens our relationship with God, and it is the act of worship and surrender. When we pray, we acknowledge that we are not in control and are welcoming God's sovereignty into our hearts. God calls for us to persistently pray for strength, for wisdom, and petition our requests with consistency, confidence, and steadfastness. When things are not going as planned or the outcome is not what we would like it to be, it is easy to stop praying or believe that God has abandoned us. Not so. Hannah is a woman in the Bible who dealt with a lot of adversity in her life, yet she was steadfast in seeking out the Lord. In 1 Samuel 1, we learn about Hannah's story and how she was one of two wives to Elkanah. Hannah was barren, and she was taunted by Peninnah, which was the second wife. And Hannah was also very angry with God. 1 Samuel 1, verses 10 through 11 says, "In deep anguish, Hannah prayed to the Lord, weeping bitterly, and she made a vow saying, Lord Almighty, if you will only look on your servant's misery and remember me and not forget your servant, but give me a son, then I will give him to the Lord for all the days of his life, and no razor will ever be used on his head. God gave Hannah a preview of what it looks like to have a baby and to raise children through Penina. Hannah began to start hating on Penina and began to pray and put her focus on God, which activated her blessing. In 1 Thessalonians 5, verses 16 through 18, it tells us to rejoice evermore, pray without ceasing, and in everything give thanks, for this is the will of God in Christ Jesus concerning you. Like Hannah, we also face difficult challenges and seasons in our life, but being diligent in seeking God in prayer will guide, uplift, and encourage us to move forward in faith. We gotta have strong faith. Our circumstances may not always yield our desired outcome, but God wants us to continuously pray to him with courage, boldness, and expectation. In Hebrews 4:16, it says, let us therefore come boldly unto the throne of grace, that we may obtain mercy and find grace to help in a time of need. Despite Hannah's challenges, she was determined to surrender and submit her cares before the Lord. She prayed through her pain and was determined to continue to trust God. There are many prominent women in the Bible, Ruth and Esther, and they have entire books to tell their story. But however, the woman we know as Hannah in the Bible is found only in 1 Samuel, yet her story is anything but insignificant. Hannah's story deals with infertility, bullying and hatred, and the power of answered prayers. Hannah isn't the first woman in the Bible to suffer infertility. First, there was Sarah, the wife of Abraham. Then it was Rebecca, the wife of Isaac. And then it was Rachel, the wife of Jacob. Yet, Hannah's response was profoundly different than theirs. She didn't blame her mate. In her pain, Hannah didn't retaliate, not to Penina or to Elkanah, her husband. She took her pain to the one who could only alleviate it, the Lord, her God. When we get angry, we sometimes take it out on other people, but not Hannah. She took her concern to the Lord. We take our problems out on other people, and later we think it's okay to go back and say, I'm sorry, I was angry about something else. But that's not the right thing to do. We need to learn to calm down, pray about it, and then speak to somebody. Sometimes just say, this is not a good time to speak with me. Something happened when Hannah took her cares directly to God. The blessing that God gave to Hannah was to open her womb. Once the Holy Spirit touched Hannah, she became a new person, and she was very bold in her spirit. Hannah prayed, and God made a way out of no way. No matter what you are going through, keep the faith and stay focused on the one who can help you. Pray your way out of your problems. In 2 Chronicles 7:14, if my people, which are called by my name, shall humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from wicked ways, then will I hear from heaven and will forgive their sin and will heal their land. There is power when you pray. Yet even in her sincere petition to God, Hannah is met with more negativity. The priest in the temple, when she prayed, accused her of being drunk and says to her, how long are you going to stay drunk? Put away the wine. That's not even the case. In 1 Samuel 1:15, it shows Hannah responds saying, not so, Lord. I am a woman who is deeply troubled. I have not been drinking wine or beer. I am pouring out my soul to the Lord. Do not take your servant for a wicked woman. I have been praying here out of my great anguish and grief. Eli, the priest, answered and said, go in peace, and may the God of Israel grant you what you have asked of him. Giving birth to Samuel is just part of Hannah's amazing story. Remember the vow she made before the Lord in the initial appeal. Hannah had every intention on keeping it. From the time her son was born until he was weaned, Hannah loved Samuel, preparing her heart for the big day. And we can understand that feeling when our children are about to graduate from any school, middle school, high school, college. We prepare them for that big day, and we are so proud of them. So I know Hannah was ready, and she prepared him for the day that she would give him away and send him to the tabernacle. After Hannah fulfilled her vow delivering Samuel to the temple, she worshiped and sang prophetically. In 1 Samuel 2, 1 through 10, which was read by Pastor Benjamina this morning, it explained how Hannah felt about the Lord for blessing her with a son. Every year, Hannah went back to the tabernacle, and every year, Eli prophesied over her, and Hannah had five more children after Samuel, three sons and two daughters. In 1 John 5:14 through 15, this is the confidence we have in approaching God, that if we ask anything according to his will, he hears us. And if we know that he hears us, whatever we ask, we know that we have what we ask of in his name. I love that scripture. We need to realize that our lives are intended to be used by God. There is more power inside the Holy Spirit than there is in the White House. We all know that God will give you the desires of your heart in God's time. In God's time, Jesus rose from the dead. In God's time, Moses parted the Red Sea and brought the people out. In God's time, he will heal your body no matter what you are going through. In God's time, we will survive the stress of the pandemic and COVID-19. And in God's time, all things are possible. In God's time, God will supply all of your needs. But it has to happen in God's time. We are facing on all levels of our life experiencing the pandemic with COVID-19, the gun violence, the war in Ukraine, the mass shootings that we see all over the United States. But we have to remember, we have an unchanging God in a rapidly changing world. He is always with us. If we are going to survive, you must learn how to accept change and the will of God. There is so much wisdom and power in understanding your identity and your destiny as a child of the King. Hannah was no different than a woman with the issue of the blood. They both had a problem that could only be solved by God. Some of us are bleeding inside with stress, with pain, with heartbreak, and maybe depression, and a lot of us are grieving. There are so many of our loved ones being killed. But you must do what Hannah did. Take your concerns to God in prayer and leave them there. Hannah began to speak positively the moment she became pregnant. She didn't even wait until the baby was born. Her prayers were answered, and she believed God for her miracle. Learn to be content with what God has already blessed you with. If you are not satisfied with where you are in your life, then it is time to make some changes to your life in a godly way. God is excellent in his own way. No matter how long you wait or as long as it takes for you to believe, the blessing will come. An hour, a day, a week, a year, 5 years, 10 years. Come on now. We always want things instant gratification. Well, that's not how God works. He works in his time. On Mark 11:22-24, it states, "So Jesus answered and said to them, 'Have faith in God, for assuredly I say to you, whoever says to this mountain, be removed and be cast into the sea, and does not doubt in their heart, but believe that those things he says will be done, he will have whatever things you ask when you pray. Believe that you will receive them and you will have them.'" Let me tell you something. It took 31 years before I felt free, raising my daughter and helping with my grandchildren. And I had been bugging my daughter right before the pandemic, "When are you going to buy this house? It is time for you to move, because now we're having differences. So I love you, but y'all need your own place." Well, God, during the pandemic, made it possible for my daughter to buy a house. But what I didn't realize is my daughter had been praying for a year and a half before God blessed her with a home around the corner from my house. I am thankful to God that she's close to me, and I thank God for blessing her, because the house that he finally gave her after waiting a year and a half was a house that she wanted. It had everything inside of it that her heart desired. We must learn to praise God until something happens. Everything won't always be good, but with faith, it will get better every day. The stronger the faith, the better the understanding, the bigger the blessing. And just like Jesus, you will go through trials and tribulations, but God is omnipresent. He is always with you. No matter what you go through, he is your footprints in the sand. During the pandemic, everybody's stress level has risen. There are so many things we are concerned with and we are worried about. But in Jeremiah 29:12, it tells us, "Then shall you call upon me, and you shall go and pray unto me, and I will hearken unto you." God is with you. It's in the scriptures. In James 1:2-3, it tells you, "My brethren, count it all joy when you fall into these various trials, knowing that the testing of your faith produces patience." All of your life is a test. As we live each day, the tests we face teach us valuable lessons. We must learn to see God's blessings as we face each trial. None of us are perfect. God has forgiven us and provided for us regardless of our faults. God still loves us. If you are willing, the Holy Spirit will overshadow you, and the hidden Christ who has locked up behind your problems, your fears, and your tears will come forth, and you will see the power of Jesus do a mighty thing in your life. Now, let me give you some pointers of when you pray. Number one, when you pray, be persistent in prayer. In 1 Samuel 1:12, states that she kept on praying to the Lord, and her prayers were not just a one-time event, but she prayed with intensity and focus. In 1 Samuel 1:15, it states she poured her soul out before the Lord. Number two, when you pray, surrender all of yourself to God, give him everything. As we continue to grow in our relationship with God and spiritual maturity, God wants us to not sugarcoat who we are or where we are. He wants us to live. At times, we may believe that God cannot handle the weight of our situation because he allows us to go through trials and tribulations. However, in our greatest season of strife and despair, God desires for us to draw close to him. God can handle every weight, every burden, every uncertainty, and every fear we have. When words are not adequate, meaning you don't know what to say, just turn to Romans 8:26, and it says, the Holy Spirit helps us in our weakness. We do not know what we ought to pray for, but the Spirit himself intercedes for us through wordless groans. God's great love for us covers us every day. Surrender all the love and allow God to move in and through you in your circumstance. Number three, when you pray, remember God's faithfulness. As Hannah prays to God, she gives him thanks and remembers his faithfulness. In 1 Samuel 2:2, there is no holy one like the Lord our God that stands beside you. There is no rock like our God. Hannah recognized God's ultimate sovereignty and that God's faithfulness prevailed. During trying times, remember God's faithfulness will strengthen, encourage, and remind us that he has not abandoned us. After God granted Hannah the blessing of her son Samuel, she continued to give him praise. Hannah's unwavering commitment to pursuing God in prayer and thanking him for continued blessings keeps us connected and encouraged that God has not forgotten us. Number four, when you pray, speak victory over your life. Hannah was taunted initially for being barren by Elkanah's second wife for years. When Hannah wept and was distraught by this ongoing ridicule, she did not stop praying. She was seeking the Lord. Although her circumstances were overwhelming and she could have easily lost hope, she resolved to be victorious in Christ Jesus. When we face difficult seasons or relationships that seem unbearable or hopeless, let us be encouraged by Hannah's commitment to trust in God. Speak life. Speak victory over those circumstances. Spirit, your future. When you are distracted by opposition, negativity, or self-doubt, that will come. But we can resolve to seek God's word for renewed hope and walk in the victory with Jesus Christ. Walking in victory doesn't mean that our challenges will instantaneously disappear, but it does mean that we have decided not to be consumed by them. Begin to walk in victory each day and let God give you the thorough seasons of opposition and strife. He'll take you through them. And last, number five, prayer is a powerful tool. Hannah's story is a powerful one of strength, courage, persistence, prayer, and unwavering commitment to seeking God's face. She faced challenging circumstances. She felt discouraged, and she got angry with God. Despite her challenges and feeling of rejection and abandonment, she did not stop praying. She prayed when she was unsure if she would ever have children, and she prayed when God blessed her with a son. And in my closing, there are times that people won't understand you because the answer lies in God's hand and not man's. You must learn to allow your flesh to meet your spirit. I'll say that again. You must learn to allow your flesh to meet your spirit. Your spirit is stronger than your flesh because you are operating in the spiritual realm of God. The moment you start to respect the anointing on your life, the spirit will flow for you and your family. In Matthew 6:63, it tells us, It is the Spirit who gives life. The flesh profits nothing, nothing. The words that I speak to you are spirit, and they are life. Prayer is a powerful tool that God wants us to use to stay connected to Him. Strengthen our spiritual maturity and use as a weapon to overcome the tactics of the enemy. When adversity comes, the good news is, and I repeat, God desires for us to draw closer to Him, and we are victorious through Christ. If you are in a season of ongoing adversity, challenges, or opposition, I invite you today to be encouraged by Hannah's story and her resilience in seeking God. Continue to be persistent in prayer. Surrender all your emotions to God and remember God's faithfulness and speak victory despite opposition. In difficult times, just remember, in difficult moments, seek God. In painful moments, trust God. In happy moments, praise God. For every moment, thank God. And the most important one, in quiet moments, worship God. My last scripture, Matthew 6:6. But when you pray, go away by yourself. Shut the door behind you and pray to your Father in private. Then your Father, who sees everything, shall reward you. Hannah, part 2, the power of prayer. Amen, amen, and amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.